start worship off by just giving thanks and praise to the one who is worthy, the only one worthy of our praise. So let's sing these words out. Come on.
Enter his gates with thanksgiving and fill his courts with praise. Give thanks to the Lord. We're here to bless his name. His love is never ending. His faithfulness remains. Give thanks to the Lord. We're here to bless his name.
You sing, shout for joy.
Shout for joy. All the earth. And make a joyful noise to the Lord. And bring your sorrows and trade.
Can be so free in our worship. Thank you for this freedom. And Lord, we say thank you for meeting us where we are today. Father, give us eyes to see and ears to hear how you see things and how you hear. Your presence is welcome. Thank you, Jesus.
God, I look to you. I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. God, I look to you. You're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom. You know just what to do. Forever worship you.
I sing that again.
God, I look to you. I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. God, I look to you. You're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom. You know just what to do. And I will love you, Lord, my strength. And I will love forever all my days.
sing that again. Hallelujah, our God reigns. Thank you, Lord.
That's Testify of your goodness and of your faithfulness today. Where would we be without it, God? Help us to lean fully on you, Lord Jesus, not of our own understanding, but of you, God. Teach us to trust. We love you, Lord, and we ask these things in your holy name. Amen. You guys can take a seat.
Everybody, I'm Ashley, and welcome to this month's edition of the Dollar Club, our opportunity to give just one extra dollar and see the amazing things that can happen when we all do good together. Today, we're sitting down with Renee from the Dixon County Help Center, an organization that has been serving the community for more than 45 years.
Thank you so much just for being here today. Can you tell us a little bit just about the organization and what you all do?
So people would apply for food stamps. And food stamps back then would take weeks to get, and so they decided to form a food bank. Back in 1978-79, Miss Helen Ryle, she decided to start it up out of her basement. In 2011, we purchased the building off of Main Street, and we've been there just growing ever since. We are working with thousands of families. We have a couple of really powerful programs that we do. Through our food bank, we assist about 150 families a week, and we provide a grocery cart full of food for them. We feed between 250 and 350 households with mobile food pantries. We do the backpack meal program through the school system here. We deliver food to about 75 elderly disabled shut-ins. We also do utility assistance and housing and medication assistance. The thrift store has a couple of different components with it because the people in our community can donate gently used items and then we will place them on the shelves to sell. But it also gives us an organized outlet that if someone comes in and they need help with clothes, with furniture, household items, we can send them out with a voucher and they can just get what they need.
Tell me just a little bit about the people that you're serving each and every day.
The people that we're serving each and every day are people just like us. You know, a lot of times people have that misconception that we're serving people who just choose not to work. But until you're put in that situation, you don't understand that situation. By the time I was 18, I was a high school dropout with two children and found myself doing a lot of different things to try to help feed my kids. I know what it's like to just be at the end of your rope and to say, you know, where can I go? I would be standing on the corner at the 7-Eleven begging people for their little coupons just so I could get a dollar or two to go back in and get some bread or something inexpensive to feed my kids, or while I was selling my plasma just to pay utilities. I never in my life thought I'd be where I am today, never. I decided, you know, once I got through that season, I wanted to be the person that could come back and say, hey, I can help. And I want to use my story to offer people hope.
Is there anything specific right now that you guys are doing or working toward?
We are trying to get us a new box truck. It's on its last leg, and our lift gate is not working very well. We are partners of Second Harvest, so we get to pick up grocery rescue from all of the stores here in Dickson County. So now we're struggling to be able to go get those items. We're working toward a 10 by 10 walk-in freezer because we do take perishable foods and we've run out of space. What I'm dreaming about for years to come is a new facility, more of a campus. We would have our thrift store, food bank, and our assistance programs, but we would also be able to offer classes and we could help them get prepared for jobs.
What do you hope for the people who come and are a part of the Help Center? What do you hope for their lives after they've come through your doors?
I hope that they experience love and dignity. That's our goal, is to experience that. The seasons that we're in are not where we have to stay. There's always hope for a better future. And, you know, regardless of how you started out, regardless.
Hey, can I jump in?
Absolutely, absolutely.
Thank you so much for sitting down and talking to us today. I don't know if you know, at CrossPoint, we have this thing called the Dollar Club, where once a month we ask everybody in the church to throw in an extra dollar, pull that money together, find a need in the community that needs to be filled, and go fill it. We love the work that you are doing at the Dickson County Help Center, and you are making such a difference in this community and helping so many people. And so we wanted to come alongside you. So we have a check for you for $10,000 to help take care of whatever it is that you all need right now.
Thank you. Thank you so much. An unrestricted gift, such as this, that you say, wherever the need is, those are the gifts that, oh my gosh, you will have no idea the impact this will have. And so thank you.
It is so incredible, whether that's your first time or your thousandth time, what we get to be a part of. We are invited not to only watch that story, but to know that it is us all doing good together that makes stories like that possible. And Renee, I love your story. I just think what a beautiful picture of the way that God can transform a story into a powerful way of helping people find and follow Jesus. And if you're new to CrossPoint, that's why we're here. We exist to help people find and follow Jesus. And the Dickson County Help Center is our local partner for This or That, our kids' experience coming up in just a little over a week. We are gearing up for that. So excited for that. If your kids or your friends' kids are not signed up yet, be sure to get them signed up. But we want to partner with organizations just like Renee and the Dickson County Help Center because we want kids to be invited into a story that's bigger than their own. That's what we do here at church, is we are invited into moments and stories like that. So we're excited about that. And what I love about Renee's story is she gets to lead, she gets to serve, she gets to make a difference now from a place of knowing what it feels like to need help. And I think that's all of our story at some level. And that's why we give here at CrossPoint, is knowing how good our God is, that we want to play a part in making a difference right here in our community. And so as our guest experience team comes forward to receive offering, I want to invite you into stories like that. We give toward the mission of helping people find and follow Jesus. And if you're new today, there's no expectation or pressure for you to give, but I do want to invite you to be a part of what God is doing here. And if you'd like to give today, in addition to the buckets that are being passed in the room, if you're with us online, information on how to give will be on the screen beside us. We give toward the mission. We also pray toward that mission. We pray in this auditorium every Tuesday at 11 o'clock. And I want to bring that back up and invite you to be a part of it as we gather to pray. What we're praying for is for renewal in the church around Nashville, revival in our city, and awakening, a spiritual awakening across Middle Tennessee. And so we gather in smaller groups to pray. We get to worship in this space together again every Tuesday at 11 a.m. Listen, maybe you're here online and this will be the first opportunity for you to come see the campus and be a part. I'm here every Tuesday. And we'll love the opportunity to pray with you and to talk more about that. Before we continue in our series today, K for a King, Pastor Justin Johnson, who's our Franklin campus pastor, good friend of mine, has recorded to share his story about how prayer just like that has influenced his story. And so let's check that out together.
growing up, I was pretty convinced that all I had to do was work really hard and then my life was going to be good. I was able to accomplish a lot, and as I accomplished things, my life still felt unfulfilled. So I haven't always been a campus pastor. Actually, prior to this, I was a pharmacist. It wasn't until I went to college that I started going to church. Me and Bridget met in pharmacy school, and I started going to church with her. I heard the gospel, and even though I had a lot of questions about what it all meant, I surrendered my life to the Lord. I was actually riding home from church in the back of my friend's car, and I felt like the Lord spoke to me. The Lord just kind of said it in my heart that I was gonna go into ministry. So I finished school, graduated, and it was about 15 years between when I felt like God put it on my heart that I was gonna be going into ministry and when I actually said yes to a ministry job. And God really prepared my heart in order to do that. And one of the things that he grew me in was the importance of surrendering to him. Where I had previously lived this life of trying to perform and trying to do everything in my own power, God taught me that everything that I have has come from him and that he's in control of everything. But when I went into ministry, I just continued to do the same thing. I surrender every conversation that I have to the Lord. I surrender every time I get up on stage to him. I surrender the way that I parent. I just surrender everything to the Lord. God has shown me that we can actually walk with him throughout the day. There's a scripture that says, pray continually. Some people don't have a regular rhythm of stepping into prayer, but one thing that we do as a church is we have this prayer time so that people can come and pray and be prayed for. We just create some space so that whether you feel like you're a newbie or whether you feel like you're really seasoned in prayer, everybody can come. There can be this temptation to try to walk with the Lord alone. But God has made it so that there's power in us getting together. Try to take off any pressure that you've put on in terms of trying to say something profound or eloquent or use the right words. Just know, God loves you more than you know, and he can't wait for you to just create some space and have a conversation. He understands our brokenness, and he understands that we're not always going to be happy. And so God is so kind to when we spend time with him, when we pray with him, when we pour out our hearts to him, he can actually be the lifter of our head.
Welcome to CrossPoint, and we are so excited about prayer night tonight. At all of our other campuses other than Nashville, we'll be having prayer night tonight at 5:30 p.m. Would love for you to join for campus prayer. If you're part of the Nashville campus, that's every Tuesday at 11. You're invited to join us. And here's what we know. We know that you can go through history and you see every great move of God began with a small group of people praying. And you can go back even in our own stories, in my own life story, I can go back and look and I can see those anything's possible moments. Well, they all go back to prayer. When I've seen and experienced miracles in my life and known other people to experience miracles, they can be traced back to prayer. And so we would invite you to be a part of that with us. And I love Pastor Justin. Been running with Pastor Justin. There's a small group of guys, actually my small group. We meet together on Saturdays and we run. And we run 5 miles, and then we pray together, and these guys, well, Pastor Justin's faster. He's fast, and so I've found that if I can ask him questions and get him talking, it slows him down a little bit. So I ask a lot of. He's got great things to say, but also to just slow him down and the conversational pace, and in our relationship with God, there's a conversational pace. And for us to hear from God and for us to encounter his presence, well, oftentimes it requires that we slow down. And that's what we're talking about in this series. K for a king, we're looking at the story of David, King David, who was anointed by God to be king, but yet King Saul chased him down and he lived 15 years on the run from King Saul. And during that time, he went from cave to cave. He lived oftentimes in the strongholds, but it was during that time in the cave that God strengthened his faith and God developed his character and God steeled his resolve and his focus in life. And it was in that cave that God prepared David for what he had prepared for him. that God never wastes the time in the cave. And so in this series, we've been extending the invitation, and our prayer and our hope is that you would find a cave, that you would find a place where you can meet with God, where you can pull away from all the distractions and devices of this world, and you can encounter his presence, that you can meet with him. There is this incredible invitation that's in Scripture. It's in James chapter 4, verse 8, and it says, "Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you." It says, if you draw near to God, that he will draw near to you. This is an amazing invitation. The God of all creation, the King of kings, the Lord of lords, the CEO of the universe is saying, if you draw near to him, that he will draw near. God is not going to force himself upon you, but that if you draw near to him, he will draw near to you. This is incredible. I got an invitation this week. I had a Bono, lead singer for U2. He reached out to a mutual friend and asked if I wanted to go have coffee at Barista Parlor. But I wasn't able to go because I had a dentist appointment. I just made that up. Because there's no way I would miss a meeting with Bono for a dentist appointment. Sorry, Dr. Portis. There is no way that I'm gonna miss that. And that's Bono. And here we have God, the one who invented Bono, the one who made all that exists. His invitation to you is to draw near to him. And through Jesus Christ, through his blood that was shed for us, we approach the throne. We can approach him with confidence. And the invitation is God saying, if you'll just draw, think about that. God desires your presence, that he wants to hang with you, that he wants to be with you. And so this is the most amazing invitation where God says, if you draw near to me, I'll draw near to you. It's the heart of the Father. It's God's desire to be wanted. And when we want him, he says, I'll draw near to you. And I struggled with this for years. Even as a pastor, I struggled with this. And early on in my pastoral career, I just got honest with the executive pastor at the church I was at. And I was like, I really struggle with regular, consistent time with God. And I'm so glad that in that, have you noticed that in moments of vulnerability, when we'll just ask for help, that God will oftentimes just bring, like when the student is ready, the teacher appears. And so I asked him, I said, can you help me? He said, yeah, Kevin. He said, Dr. Dan Ryland, he said, pick a time, pick a place, have a plan. He said, pick a time and have a place. And the thing that's been most helpful for me in the past 20 years is having a place, where I can consistently and regularly meet with God. And it's been different places. That's what we're talking about when we say a cave. It's been different places in different years. Sometimes it's been a chair in the living room. Other seasons it's been a seat on the back porch. Other times it's been a desk down in a closet, down in the basement. Other times it's been a table at a coffee house. Other times it's been trails at the park. It's been different places but it's been a place where I can tune out all the distractions. It's been places where I can shut off all the devices and places where I can listen to God. Pastor Justin, he mentioned that verse. He says, pray continually. And when we think about that verse, oftentimes we just keep talking. And God loves it when you talk to him. He loves to hear from you. But prayer is a two-way communication. It is God communicating to us, and so it's us listening. I believe God's always speaking. The question is, are we always listening? And so to listen requires us to slow down to a conversational pace to hear from him, and it's the practice of meeting with God. And the reason we call it practice is because none of us do it perfectly. We're practicing together. We can all get better at this. And in this series, we've been looking at the Psalms that David wrote in the caves, during that cave season. We're looking at Psalm 57. And since it was a song originally, we're going to be accompanied by some music. Thanks, Will. And we're going to read through this Psalm together and just let these words from David, the Word of God, just wash over you and set your heart on him. Psalm 57. It says, have mercy on me. My God, have mercy on me. For in you I take refuge. I will take refuge in the shadow of your wings until the disaster has passed. I cry out to God Most High, to God who vindicates me. He sends from heaven and saves me. rebuking those who hotly pursue me, God sends forth his love and his faithfulness. I am in the midst of lions. I am forced to dwell among ravenous beasts, men whose teeth are spears and arrows, whose tongues are sharp swords. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth. They spread a net for my feet. I was bowed down in distress. They dug a pit in my path, but they have fallen into it themselves. My heart, O God, is steadfast. My heart is steadfast. I will sing and make music. Awake, my soul. Awake, harp and lyre. I will awaken the dawn. I will praise you, Lord, among the nations. I will sing of you among the peoples. For great is your love, reaching to the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches to the skies. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth. So Lord, we pray that even now, that you would take the words of this psalm, written 3,000 years ago, 6,000 miles from here, and that by the power of your Spirit, that you would speak to us, that you give us a roadmap for our hearts, a roadmap to draw near to you when we face trouble. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So David is in his 20s when he's writing this. How many of you are in your 20s? Just go ahead. How many of you wish you were in your 20s? How many of you are pretending to still be in your 20s? David is in his 20s and he's on the run, like, for his life. King Saul is trying to kill him. David was anointed as king when he was 14, given the promise that one day he would be king. But he's having to wait for that. And King Saul is threatened by him because David is, God's just blessing his life. And King Saul feels threatened. So Saul tried to kill him, tried to pin him to the wall with a spear. And David evaded him, and then he tried to do it again. The first time, you're like, maybe he's having a bad day. Second time, maybe he wants to kill me. No, he wants to kill me. So David's on the run, and he goes and he lives among the caves, and that is where he's writing this psalm. He's writing this psalm. Let me show you a view. This is actually, they've uncovered what they believe to be the cave of Adullam, where David was, when it's believed that he would have wrote this psalm. He's being hunted like a wild animal, and he's in this cave, and he's tired, and he's weary, and he's exhausted, and he's lonely, and he's confused, and he's afraid. Have you ever been there? Have you ever been in a place like that emotionally or relationally? Maybe spiritually? Where you just feel like, man, this problem that I'm facing is bigger than me. This situation that I'm up against is greater than, I don't know what to do. Maybe you're thinking, like, the math doesn't work. You're thinking, there's no way I can whiteboard session. There's no strategy I can put on a whiteboard to get me through that. Maybe it's an issue at work, or maybe it's a problem at home, or maybe it's something that's going on in parenting or in your career. Maybe it's a legal battle that you're up against, or maybe a financial struggle that you're facing, or maybe a diagnosis that you've received. If that's the case, you have a sense of what David is experiencing in this. What do you do when you face a problem that is bigger than you? It's what David is facing. And David gives us turn-by-turn directions. He's going to give us turn-by-turn directions on what to do. And the first thing we do that we see in this psalm is turn upward to God. Turn upward to God. We turn upward to a God who is bigger than our problems. In those moments when we're on the run, or on those moments when we're facing problems, we can obsess about the problem. But the first thing that we see David do in this, But the first thing that we see David do in this moment in the cave is that he turns upward to God. Look with me at verse 1. It says, "Have mercy on me, my God, have mercy on me, for in you I take refuge. I will take refuge in the shadow of your wings until the disaster has passed. I cry out to God Most High, to God who vindicates me. He sends from heaven and saves me, rebuking those who hotly pursue me. God sends forth his love and his faithfulness." And what I want you to see what David is doing is that instead of starting with the way that he feels, David starts with the God that he knows. See, instead of starting with the way that he feels, David starts with the God that he knows. He starts with the truth about the God that he knows. He starts with God's character. He starts with his nature. He starts with his attributes. For years, my wife Rhea has been leading moms in prayer. And every week she gets moms together and they pray for their children. And there's a sheet of paper that kind of guides as a roadmap through their prayer time. And every week there's an attribute of God. Part of his nature or who he is, a characteristic. And so we see here, David, he's starting with the character and nature of God, that we can know God. John chapter 17, verse 3, Jesus said, "Now this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you have sent." This is the only place in the New Testament where eternal life is defined, where Jesus gives a definition. He says eternal life is knowing God. It's a relationship where we can know God and we can know who he is and how he is. We can know his ways. We can know his heart. Jesus says, if you want to know the Father, look at me. So in other words, Jesus is telling us that he is perfect theology. When we read the Gospels, we see the character and the nature, the heart of God. We see the way that God is. And David starts with this character and the nature of God. He's telling us who God is. And when we read the scripture, we should ask the question, what does this passage tell us about God? So often when we read the scripture, we read it like people read a yearbook. How do people read a yearbook? What do students do when they get a yearbook? What's the first thing they do? They open it up and what do?
Look for them.
They look for people. When I read it, when I would get my yearbook and I would open it up, I'd start looking for pictures of me. And oftentimes we open up the scriptures, we start looking, where am I in the story? But this is the story of God. It's the story of who he is. It's the story of his redemptive nature. It's the story of the heart of God, the love of God, the mercy of God, the grace of God. It's the story of God coming to us in the person of Christ. This entire book points to Jesus. It tells the story of Christ's love for us. And so when we read the book, we should ask a question. A guiding question is, what does this passage tell us about God? And so when we read Psalm 57 and read through the Psalm, what does this highlight for us about God? Well, just in the three verses that we looked at, we see that God is merciful and that he is a refuge and that he protects us and he hears and he is most high and he vindicates us and he comes to us and he sends and he saves. He's loving, he's faithful. And when you're facing a problem that's bigger than you, you need to know that truth, because there is a God who is bigger than your problem. And so David, he anchors himself in this truth about the nature of God. And sometimes we forget. Sometimes we just rush right into prayer with a grocery list, like God's our Instacart. We're like, God, I need this, and we can rush in to give us this day our daily bread. But Jesus said, no, when you pray, begin this way. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name, holy be your name. Jesus said, start with who your Father, remember who your Father is, that you have a Father that's gonna care for you, that you don't have an orphan spirit. That your Father cares for you. He sees your need. He's going to provide for you. So start with who God is and then bring him the anxieties, the cares, the concerns, the needs of your life. Because your Father knows what you need before you even ask. And he's going to care for you. But sometimes it's good in prayer just to pause for a second and just remember who we're talking to. The King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the one who governs the universe. To remember who we're talking to. So when we're facing a problem that's bigger than us, when you're facing a problem that's bigger than you, the first thing to do, David shows us, is to turn upward. To turn upward. To turn to a God who's bigger than your problem. The second turn, if you're following turn-by-turn directions on the ways of Psalm 57, is turn inward and face your heart. Turn inward and face your heart. Here's what this is. This is bringing the real you to the real God. See, it's important when we pray that we really, we're praying who we're praying to the real God. But then also we bring the real us, our needs to God. This is where we bring our inner world. You know the first question that God asks in the scriptures, the first question that we find in the Bible? God asks the question. He asks the question to Adam and Eve, and it's the question, where are you? Genesis 3, verse 9, where are you? Now the Hebrew word aika that he asked them this question after Adam and Eve sinned in the garden, after they rebelled against God. It says they went and hid. Shame always leads to hiding. But God is a finder. He is a pursuer. He seeks them out and he asks the question, Aika, where are you? Not where are your bodies? Not, hey, can somebody put an air tag on Eve? Can somebody get Adam on Life 360? Like, can we just figure out how to track down Adam? He's not asking about where they're at physically. He's asking about their hearts. And it's the question God still asks. Where are you? I can be at dinner with my family and maybe I'm thinking about a problem at work or a situation that I'm trying to solve or something that's going on, and I can be obsessing that about that and turning that over and over in my head. And Rhea will look at me and she'll go, where are you? Because like, we're here at dinner, but you're not. Like, you're somewhere else. She knows. So she asks, that's Aika. And God knows. I can be sitting in the cave. I can be sitting in that place. I can be sitting in a seat on the back porch and I can be just in a moment of prayer and kind of going through the motions. And it's like, God's like, well, where are you? Where's your heart really? I can get hung up in something that I said or something that I did or something that didn't work out. I can get hung up and man, that God would ask that question because he wants me to bring the real me, my heart, to him. He is so kind and so merciful. That's why he asked the question. God still asks that question. Proverbs 20 verse 27 says, the spirit of a person is the lamp of the Lord, searching all the innermost parts of his being. The Holy Spirit is the lamp of God that enables us to search our hearts. You know the reason that that most people don't go in caves? Because they're scared. There are more caves in Tennessee than any other state in the United States. So you have more opportunity living in caves. You have all the opportunity to go in caves. So the opportunity is there. But many of us don't go in caves because we're scared what we'll find. The same is true with our own hearts. When it comes to our own fears, our own desires, our own motivations, our own longings, our past, our regrets, a lot of us avoid going into that space because we don't know what we'll find. But we can trust the light of God's word. We can trust the lamp of the Spirit to illuminate, to reveal the places that we need to heal and that God wants to forgive and the thing he wants to work on. But many of us would rather do anything. They go, I mean, you... In the world, people would rather do a lot of things than go into what's really going on in their heart. So people do all kinds of things. They drink too much and abuse meds and hook up and binge watch and binge eat and binge shop. Excessive work and mindless scrolling. Anything to keep from dealing with what's going on in here. And the invitation of God is, and listen, it is his kindness that leads to repentance. It's not our repentance that leads to his kindness. It's his kindness that leads to our repentance. And repentance is coming back home where God says, where are you? Here I am. And bringing the real you to the real God. And this is what David does. David brings the real him to God. Verse 4, he says, I am in the midst of lions. I'm forced to dwell among ravenous beasts, men whose teeth are like spears and arrows, whose tongues are like sharp swords. David's like, it is bad. It is really bad. King Saul wants to kill me. I am afraid. You can just hear the fear. He's afraid. He's just frozen up and paralyzed in fear. And so he's talking about what's going on in his heart. He's saying, people are saying all kinds of stuff. He's surrendering his reputation to God. He's like, God, you know all the things that they're saying about me. And Spurgeon said, if you're among lions, you will have fellowship with Jesus and his church. If you're among lions, you'll be driven nearer to your God. If you're among lions, remember that God has them on a leash. If you're among lions, remember there's another lion, the lion of the tribe of Judah. Isn't that good? David's giving God the real. He's giving him his heart. And then David makes this quick turn, doesn't even put on a blinker, just makes a quick turn, and he turns upward again and he gives glory to God. He says, be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth. David looks up. He's like, I'm not gonna focus on my problems. I'm not gonna focus on my circumstances. I'm gonna look up. And he gives God glory before God does anything. He gives God glory because God is worthy. He looks up and he gives God praise and he gives God glory. He says, let your glory be over all the earth. And he's lifted. You can just picture him walking out of that cave, looking up at the skies. We don't know if it's nighttime and he's looking up at the stars. We don't know if it's daytime. He's looking up at the clouds, but he's looking up and there's something that happens when we look up. Neuroscience is just catching up with what David knew all along. Because what they tell us is that when we look up, it activates a part of our brain that connects with what's beyond us, with what's outside of time and space. Even the process of just looking up, that it changes our mood and it changes our perspective. And I'm like, man, it's like our world is designed to keep us from looking up. We look down at our phones. We look down at our screens. We look down at our work. When was the last time that you just walked outside and just looked up? It's a powerful thing for us to look up. And you just picture David. David's looking up and he's like, God, your glory, your majesty. And he's giving praise. He turns upward in that moment. That when we look up, it changes the way we see. It changes the way we think. It changes the way we feel. So in those moments where out of fear, maybe you want to cower back to a corner, I want to encourage you to just step outside and look up. And just look up to the skies and remember the one who made the heavens, the one who made the cosmos, the one who holds it all together. Well, he's holding you. And so David turns upward and prays. And then let me show you something wild. I picture David walking outside this cave. This is the view outside of the cave. Now, if you walk outside of that cave of Adullam, and you walk out, and you walk a little further, and you look out off into the distance, not far away, you can see the Valley of Elah. Do you remember what happened in the Valley of Elah? We talked about it in week one. The Valley of Elah was where David conquered Goliath, where David defeated Goliath. Think about this. He's on the run. He's on the run from King Saul. Years later, he walks out and he can see in his view where Goliath fell. He's remembering and reflecting on the victories that God has given him in the past. He's remembering the faithfulness of God. He's remembering how God showed up in the past. And in that moment, when we remember what God has done, he bolsters our faith. He builds us up because we remember, God, you've been faithful. Then you're going to do it again. God, you were with me then, you are with me now. God, giants fell in the past, giants will fall again. God, you will protect me. The promise that you gave me is sure and secure. I am standing and I will praise you because, God, of what you've done and what you're doing right now. And so David, you just see him in this moment as he turns up, he looks out and he sees and he's reminded of the faithfulness of God. And he continues in verse 7, my heart, oh God, is steadfast. My heart is steadfast. That word steadfast means to be fixed on. It means to be set. It means to bring something into being with reality. So David's like, God, you're bringing my real heart, where I'm really at, into being with reality. With the reality of your presence, with the reality of who you are and who you say you are. God, you're bringing my heart is steadfast, it is sure and secure. And you sense David being straight. He says it two times. Two times in the beginning, he asked for what? Mercy. And now two times he's saying, God, my heart is steadfast. So God's answered him. He's given him mercy. He's given him a strong heart that David brings to the Lord. And nothing of his circumstances have changed. But everything changed inside. This is the power of the cave. This is the power of the Spirit of God. When we're alone with God, he strengthens us on the inside. And then David turns outward and prays, verse 7. He says, I will sing and make music. Awake my soul. Awake harp and lyre. Those are stringed instruments. David's like, if I had a guitar right now, you can play guitar. There are a lot of people play. But when you play your instrument for the Lord, like when you use your musical gifts for his glory and for his honor, there is nothing like it. And David's like, if I just had my instrument, if I just had it right now, God, I would play it for you. But he says, I will awaken the dawn. I will praise you, Lord, among the nations. I will sing of you among the peoples, for great is your love reaching to the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches to the skies. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth. David's like, he's outside the cave. He's like, I can't keep what you just did, God. I can't keep it in here. I gotta let other people know. That's how you know you've had an encounter with God. When you have an encounter with God, you gotta let other people know about it. He's like, I can't keep this to myself. He's like, I'm gonna wake up people. I'm gonna wake up nations. I'm gonna wake up the earth. I'm gonna let my song, I'm gonna let my praise be known. Some people praise God like the cicadas. Like once every 17 years, every 13 years. David's like, I'm going to sing like the birds. I'm going to sing every single, I'm going to wake up. I was sitting out on the porch. I was listening to the birds and I was like, you know, I was like, praise God, the cicadas are gone. Those locusts are gone. Like, some of you love them. I don't know who you are, but like those, I'm just like, I'm listening to the birds and I'm like, man, these birds have been praising him every single morning. And you know the reason that the birds sing in the morning? They're letting the other birds know I made it through the night. And when we praise him, when we sing to him, we're like, I made it through the night. That dark season, that dark time, the time when I was facing problems that were bigger than what I had, I'm going to tell you, God made it. God brought me through, so I'm going to give him praise. I'll sing even in the night. There is a friend of mine, and she has stage 4 cancer, and she comes to church, and when she does, she sings out, she belts out, she sings her praise, her arms lifted high. She's facing a problem that's bigger than her, but not bigger than God. And she gives him praise and she gives him glory. And I draw strength. It bolsters my faith when I see her praise. And I'll tell you my dream, my prayer is that Music City becomes Worship City. That Music City becomes Worship City. That Nashville takes a deep inhale of the gospel and then exhales it to the world. And that the world, I believe that what happens in Middle Tennessee can change the world. If God brings revival, when God brings revival to our cities, to our lives, to our homes, but it's not just what's gonna happen on platforms. It's what's gonna happen on back porches and at the park and in your car before you go into work and in your living room. That as we give him praise because he's worthy, that we wake up the morning with his praise. I was reading through the Gospels and I saw that Jesus did something when he was praying the night before he was betrayed and before he went to the cross. He's in the upper room with his disciples and he was praying with them. He was praying for them. And just think about that. He knew that he was going to die on the cross and he's praying for them. He knew that he was going to go to the cross and he's washing their feet. He knew that he was going to go to the cross and he's concerned with them. He feeds them. Nobody has ever loved you like Jesus. He's concerned with them. And it says when he prayed for them, I've never seen this detail in the text, but John tells us when he prayed for them, it says he looked up. See, Jesus knew what David did because it's hardwired. He had hardwired it into us. He looks up. Just the sheer act of looking up when he prayed. And then after they leave that upper room, they walk out of that room and they're walking down toward the garden and he starts leading them in a song. They start singing. And I was like, what song were they singing? And tradition tells us that at the Passover time, traditionally they would have sang Psalm 118. And Psalm 118 says this, you can read it, but it says, the stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This is what Jesus was singing before he went to the cross. The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We used to sing this song. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. You sang it too. And we sang that in Vacation Bible School as a little kid. And I'm like, I didn't know we were in Vacation Bible School together, but Jesus is singing, this is the day that the Lord has made before he goes to the cross. He's about to face a problem that is bigger than him, but not bigger than the Father's plan. He's put to something that will lead to his death. But the reason that Jesus could sing and give praise to God is because he knew that the cross wasn't the end, that the resurrection was coming. And the same is true for you. You can sing because you know that the resurrection is coming. That the same one who raised Christ up will raise you up. And the very same spirit that raised Christ from the dead lives in you. And it's that spirit that enables us when we face problems that are bigger than us to turn upward. turn inward and deal with what's really going on. Where are you? And to turn outward with our praise and let others know. And maybe you feel lost, and maybe you feel confused, and maybe you feel overwhelmed, and maybe you've got a problem, and you're like, I can't do this on my own. You're right. And we're gonna have our prayer team down front at all of our campuses at the end of service. We would love to pray with you. You don't need to go through this by yourself. But I would, as your pastor, I just want to encourage you, the practice that's made the biggest difference in my life is having a place where I began to build a history with God. And we can pray for you, and we can ask for God to impart things and do things and work miracles. But the one thing that we can't give you is a history with God. You have to go get that yourself. And if that practice of having a cave, having a place, having a time would lead toward that, I think that's one of the greatest miracles, because when we draw near to him, he draws near to us. Let me pray for you in that. Would you bow your heads and your hearts with me? Or you can look up if you want to. Father, I thank you. I thank you for your word and how your servant David points us to Jesus. And how in Christ we see that we have access to you. So Father, I pray that right now that you would stir up desire. You said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. If you want more hunger for God, you just ask him. Just ask him, God, I want to want you more. God, just ask the question. You can just ask him. God, how do I need to know you right now? Merciful, his Father, is gracious, gentle, loving, kind. Truth. How would you reveal how we need to know you right now? And would you give us the grace daily to know what we need to know about you, at the same time to know what's going on in our hearts? Thank you that you can handle the real us. Thank you that we don't have to pretend with you. And then God, I pray that we would be a people who praise you amidst the problems. Because God, we know that we can trust you and that you will pull us through. And may we be quick to give you all glory and honor and praise. So God, I look forward to what you're gonna give tomorrow morning. What you're gonna give to people tomorrow. And then, Lord, how we can live this out and see up there come down here through us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. I want to thank you for being with us today. We're going to continue the series next week. Hope you'll be back for that. You guys have a great weekend, Lord.